Good morning, class 11C. Again, we're going to continue with the chapter Silk Road. And we have seen in a couple of videos that how difficult the terrain is, the high altitude. We've seen about religious pilgrimages. And as you all know, what is this chapter about? It is about, yes, it's the Silk Road. It's a very important ancient historical trade route. And the narrator, what does he try to do? He's trying to replicate that and to see what difficulties the people must have faced. And yes, also about the changes which have happened. That was so many years ago. Now so many things have changed. And as we read it, we come to know about, so in the hilly areas, in the mountainous regions, what are the problems that people face? But yes, here, in spite of all the challenges, so naturally for trade purposes also, the people, they went on, they continued. And even now, for religious purposes, for their faith, they are under ready to undertake very difficult journeys, right? So we'll look at the screen and we'll continue the reading of the chapter. So what has happened here? Yes, so as they're going higher and higher, what is the problem that the narrator had to face? One was that they came across a patch of road which was very slippery, very difficult to go through. There was snow on it, and the problem was that the road would have become slippery. So what did Seton do? So Seton, he went out and then they, sprinkled or threw some dirt on it so that it would become easier for them to travel across the snow, right, to go through it, drive through it. Then after some patch again, they came through this great swathe or this ribbon of snow on the road. But this time they decided to maneuver side by, outside it along the bank. So it was a steep path which they decided to take. And at the high altitude, what did they notice? Yes, that the volume, and so was there increasing the lower pressure, so the petrol tank. So yes, so Seton, he released the pressure, and so as that, no problem could happen there. So what are the things that they have noticed? So what is it? So what is the altitude they are now at? They are at the top of the pass. So as we had seen in the video earlier, so there was one path that was from the pass, right? So nowadays it is with the Nathula Pass. It is the highest motorable pass, right? So there are different ways where you can reach the Lake Mansarovar, right? So one is through Uttarakhand, the other is from, people, they go from Sikkim also. So we have seen all those routes where they manage. So he's managed there, gone through the pass, and it is at a high altitude, quite a high altitude, at 5,515 meters. And what was there? There was a large cairn of rocks. So this pile of rocks was there, and it was decorated with white silk scarves and ragged prayer flags. So as people went there, they started on their journey, they continued on with the pilgrimage, they stopped there, they said a prayer, they would tie flags over there. And even, yes, the narrator and the two men who were accompanying him, okay, right? And Seton and Daniel, both of them, they also, what did they do? They just went around it in a clockwise direction. And yeah, so right, praying for safety, praying for what? That their journey should be without any kind of a problem. So, and is the tradition, so the following the Buddhist tradition, and Seton checked the tires on his vehicle because, yes, so what had happened here? So how they had to go, the maneuver, the snow, and yes, it is a very difficult road which they are traveling on. So Seton checked the tires on his vehicle. He stopped at the petrol tank and partially unscrewed the top, which emitted a loud hiss. The lower atmospheric pressure was allowing the fuel to expand. So yes, there was low pressure and the fuel was expanding. So he just removed the excess of that pressure there. It sounded dangerous to me, Maybe, sir, seat allowed, but no smoking. So, of course, it was a little dangerous. So, little things, you know, if we are there as amateurs, we don't know much about our vehicles, we might ending causing great damage, not only to ourselves, but to our vehicles also. So, when you go to such difficult places, when you undertake such journeys, so it is better that you should have all the information and you should take an experienced person along with you, right? My headache soon cleared as we careered down the other side of the path. So, careered down. So, now that is the best part. That is when you're coming downhill. So, it was easy. And what was happening to the narrator, he felt the pressure build up in his ears, isn't it? Right? And now he's having a headache, but it was a little better as they were coming down. They're decreasing the altitude. It was 2 o'clock by the time we stopped for lunch. We ate hot noodles inside a long canvas tent, part of a work camp erected beside a dry salt lake. The plateau is pockmarked with salt flats and brackish lakes, vestiges of the Tethys Ocean, which bordered Tibet before the great continental collision that lifted it skyward. This one was a hive of activity, men with pickaxes and shovels trudging back and forth in their long sheep skin coats and salt encrusted boots. All wore sunglasses against the glare as a steady stream of blue trucks emerged from the blindingly white lake laden with piles of salt. Now here, what could they see as they're coming down? They've come to the plateau. What is it pockmarked? Pockmarked, Nishan. So what was it there, you know, marked with? Salt flats and brackish lakes. So there were lakes and there was the salt flats. Vestiges of the Tethys Ocean, which bordered Tibet before the great continental collision that lifted it skyward. So before, you know, like what was it? Before the collision took place, which lifted Tibet, right? So if you know Tibet, it is called as the roof of the world also. Right? So here, what was it? So the remains of that ocean, it was what was there. And yes, so these salt lakes, it was a part of a very old ocean, right? So this remains, vestiges kya hote? Remains, okay? Right? And vestiges of the Tethys Ocean, which bordered Tibet before the great continental collision that lifted it skyward. This one was a hive of activity. Men with pickaxes and shovels trudging back and forth in the long sheepskin coats and salt encrusted boots. So what are the men doing? They have these pickaxes, more sharp axes here, and they are just shoveling that, picking up the salt, and they're carrying it in those trucks. So lots of, you know, like they can see large number of trucks over there, all laden with piles of salt. So what could he see? The brackish lakes. Right? And the people there, the men there working, and how were they dressed? Once again, in the long sheepskin coats and wearing long boots. All of them were wearing glasses also. Because as the sun come out and as it is reflected on the snow, it becomes very difficult. Okay? So it causes a problem to eyesight also. So it is better to keep your eyes protected and covered. By late afternoon, we had reached a small town of Hoare. Now, they have reached the town of Hoare, okay? Yeah, so please note down the places that they have come. This was the first town they stopped back on the main east-west highway that followed the old trade route from Lhasa to Kashmir. So Lhasa from Tibet to Kashmir. So yes, so where is this place? It is on the highway, which followed the route from Lhasa to Kashmir. So there is one which is there, right? You're reaching there from Uttarakhand to that place. You're coming from what? Sikkim also from that side. So it is kind of a convergence there. So there are different ways which that route could be taken. And so one point where they converge. So here it is. So he's come to this town of Hoare, a small town. Daniel, who was returning to Lhasa, found a ride in a truck. So Seaton and I bade him farewell outside a tire repair shop. So the Daniel who was there, and he was as a translator also, he was with them. So now he's left them. He's going back to Lhasa. We had suffered 2 punctures in quick succession on the drive down from the salt lake And Seaton was eager to have them fixed since they left him with no spares. So naturally, a good driver does that. He makes sure that if there's a puncture, gets it repaired immediately so that in case of any problem, in case of any kind of accident, so there is always a backup, isn't it? Yes. Besides, the second tire he'd changed had been replaced by one that was as smooth as my bald head. So the tire that had been changed, it was very risky. It was very smooth. And so such smooth tires in high areas, no, no, it is not a nice option. Okay, right. So what have we read here? Where have they come now? Which place have they reached? Can you tell me? Yes. Which place have they reached? I think so. I need to ask you a few questions. Yes, so where have they reached? They've reached four, yes. And what are the problems that they have faced? What problems have they faced? Can you tell me what are the problems? Which are there? Yes. What are the problems faced? Come on, I've discussed it with you all. Can I get a response to something? Yes, the problems faced. Yeah, they've had two punctures. Okay, very nice. Then what else? What like the headache also the narrator was facing. And yes, so the difficult in the terrain, the snow that they had come across and how they had to cross it very carefully without taking any risk. What are the things now as they are coming down? Right from the high altitude, they're coming down. What are the things that they notice? What do you think is the main livelihood, or what is it that people do apart from you can say the farming or the nomads that are there? What is it? We saw the salt lakes. So people there, yes, they're gathering the salt, putting them in the trucks. Okay, so these are the things that he has noticed. Hoare was a grim, miserable place. Obviously, it's at a high altitude and so far off. So it is not going to be something that is full of activity and life. There was no vegetation whatsoever, just dust and rocks liberally scattered with years of accumulated refuse, which was unfortunate, given that the town sat on the shore of Lake Mansarovar. So Hoare was a small town. Where was it? It was on the banks of the Lake Mansarovar. But sadly enough, considering that the place had so much of significance, this town was very dirty, very, you know, with a lot of garbage piled up over the years. Tibet's most venerated stretch of water. So Lake Mansarovar, the Tibetans, they worship it. Ancient Hindu and Buddhist cosmology pinpoints Mansarovar as the source of four great Indian rivers. So yes, in the ancient Hindu traditions, Buddhists, right, we're talking about Jains, Tibetans, all of them, for them, it is all very, very important. But it's sad, you know, things which are there so important, why don't we take care of them? Why is it that nobody bothers about cleanliness? Why do you go around littering the place? This is very, very, you know, unfortunate. And a place here, which is very holy, which is deeply, you know, what worshipped and respected, has a high place in so many religions. So Mansarovar is the source of four great Indian rivers. What are they? The Indus, the Ganges, the Satluj, and the Brahmaputra. Actually, only the Satluj flows from the lake, but the headwaters of the others all rise nearby on the flanks of Mount Kailash. So it seems only Satluj origins from here. Others are there nearby from Mount Kailash. We were then striking distance of the great mountain, and I was eager to forge ahead. They could see the mountain at a distance, and he's quite eager, you know, to go over there. And as I showed you that how, you know, the mountain, it looks from a distance. And yes, so the parikrama or the kora, which people have to perform, it takes a number of days for it. So it's almost what, more than 50 kilometers, which the people have to cover on foot, right? Some people, they go on ponies if they are not so able enough. And yes, so from the distance, they could see that very holy mountain. But I had to wait. Seton told me to go and drink some tea in Hoare's only cafe because Seton was getting the tires repaired, which, like all the other buildings in town, was constructed from badly painted concrete and had three broken windows. The good view of the lake through one of them helped to compensate for the drought. What's the drought? The wind blowing. So it was a chilly place. The wind was blowing. And yes, it is there. It could be that the tea was not good enough. So just one place there. We could get something to eat or drink. And he went there to have a cup of tea while Seton was there repairing the tires. Okay. But the view was, the lake was beautiful, which kind of compensated for the wind that was blowing. Or was it for the drought, the drink? Okay. I was served by a Chinese youth in military uniform who spread the grease around on my table with a filthy rag before bringing me a glass and a thermos of tea. So he's cleaning it, and more than cleaning it, he thinks it's making it more sticky and grimy. So he's with a filthy rag, he's cleaning the table and he's doubting whether it is making it cleaner or even dirtier than before. Right? And yes, so he's going to enjoy his tea by looking at the view of the lake. Half an hour later, Seton relieved me from my solitary confinement. Solitary kya hota hai? Alone. Confinement. He's there, right? Sitting alone in that place. And we drove past a lot more rocks and rubbish westwards out of town towards Mount Kailash. So they've left that place behind and they are driving towards Mount Kailash, getting nearer to Lake Mansarovar. And yes, to the beginning of the pilgrimage also. My experience in Hoare came as a stark contrast to accounts I had read of earlier travelers. First encounters with Lake Mansarovar, Ikai Kawaguchi, a Japanese monk who had arrived there in 1900, was so moved by the sanctity of the lake that he burst into tears. A couple of years later, the hallowed waters had a similar effect on Sven Hedin, a Swede who wasn't prone to sentimental outbursts. So, you know, like when you are there, you're a traveler, you're so interested in traveling, you want to write about your travels. You also want to read about what other people have written about the place, isn't it? So when we go to a place, don't we read about what reviews people have left behind? And then it makes us decide whether I want to go over there or not. Now, so many, many years ago, so 1900 account he had written by a Japanese monk who reached Lake Mansarovar. He has described it so beautifully and he said the beauty of the place, it just moved him to tears. And it's quite possible in 1900, it might not have been so dirty as it is now, right? So it must have been very beautiful in its raw, natural state, right? So much of harm would not have been done, or so untidy it might not have been. Then he has read another account. Who is it? A Swede, right? Sven Hedin. So he's written about Lake Mansarovar, but of course he's talking about its beauty, hallowed, right? Hallowed waters, holy waters. He's talking about that, but he did not burst into tears. So yes, the Japanese monk was definitely in tears when he described the beauty of the place. But this place, Hoare did not make the writer so amazed. And he was wondering that so many years, what did they find so beautiful? But yeah, things were much beautiful then. It was dark by the time we finally left again. And after 10:30 p.m., we drew up outside a guest house in Darchin for what turned out to be another troubled night. Another troubled night. That means earlier also he did have a problem. Kicking around in the open air rubbish dump that passed for the town of Hoare had set off my cold once more, though if truth be told, it had never quite disappeared with my herbal tea. So what is he having? He has a cold, which is quite common when you go there to the hills. Even if you've gone hale and hearty, you might catch a cold over there. So he has a cold, but it seems to have become even more worse. So they're moving towards, they're coming out in Darchin now. Now this is the second place they have come. This is where they're going to spend the night, Darchin. They stopped at Hoare for repairs. And yes, he had a cup of tea over there. And he's talked about the beauty of the place or the lack of it, right? So here, as they passed through Hor, he thought the garbage dump and everything over there, it was just kind of set off his cold again. One of my nostrils was blocked again, and as I lay down to sleep, I wasn't convinced that the other would provide me with sufficient oxygen. And we all know that when we have a cold, how terrible it is. And if you are in a high altitude, it becomes so difficult to breathe, right? And the situation is even more worse. My watch told me I was at 4,760 meters. It wasn't much higher than Ravu from where they had begun, right? And there I'd been gasping for oxygen several times every night. So Ravu was not as high as this place. There also he had a problem, but this is a little higher. So he is experiencing problem in breathing. I'd grown accustomed to these nocturnal disturbances by now, but they still scared me. So he was not able to sleep peacefully at night because of his cold, because of his condition. But still, he did feel scared. Array, what is going to happen? Will I be able to breathe or not? And at high altitudes, we become a little more cautious, a little more worried about our health. Tired and hungry, I started breathing through my mouth. So this is what happens when our nose is blocked. We start breathing through our mouths. After a while, I switched to single nostril puff, which seemed to be admitting enough oxygen. But just as I was drifting off, I woke up abruptly. Something was wrong. My chest felt strangely heavy, and I sat up, a movement that cleared my nasal passages almost instantly and relieved the feeling in my chest. Curious, I thought. Now, these are little things, you know, which it happens with all of us, but we don't really pay much attention to it. So when you have a cold, you know, you really don't wonder, kya ho raha hai, kya nahin. But when someone does talk about it, you think, yeah, I've had a similar experience. Naturally, you have difficulty in breathing. You try breathing through your mouth. You try to fall asleep. You're unable to sleep. So you sit again. Then the breathing comes better. So the whole night it passes like this. So this is what is happening with the narrator. I lay back down and tried again, same result. I was on the point of disappearing into the land of Nod. Land of Nod is the land of sleep, when something told me not to. It must have been those emergency electrical impulses again, but this was not the same as on previous occasions. This time I wasn't gasping for breath. I was simply not allowed to go to sleep. So now, again, it's happened. But what is happening now? Earlier, he did fall asleep, but then he felt as if some heaviness is on his chest. He got up again. But now he's not able to fall asleep only. So he thinks that if I sit, I'll be better, might stay alive. Sitting up once more immediately made me feel better. So once again, what is he doing? He's sitting up. I could breathe freely and my chest felt fine. But as soon as I lay down, my sinuses filled and my chest was odd. I tried propping myself upright against the wall, but now I could not manage to relax enough to drop off. I couldn't put my finger on the reason, but I was afraid to go to sleep. A little voice inside me was saying that if I did, I might never wake up again. So I stayed awake all night. So here, you know, you are there far away. You wonder, when am I going to get to a doctor? And you're worried about your health. And this is what happened to him. So he's trying to fall asleep. But as he lays down, what happens? His nose is blocked. He gets up again. And then, of course, he was not able to fall asleep. So now he decides, I'm going to sit only. But he was afraid of lying down and falling asleep. And something telling him, "Arey, if you fall asleep, you might not wake up again." So he's scared. He's worried. Seton took me to the Darchin Medical College the following morning. So now Lenny have decided to go and visit a doctor. The medical college at Darchin was new and looked like a monastery from the outside, with a very solid door that led into a large courtyard. So he's gone to the medical college, and that medical college looked like a monastery. We found the consulting room, which was dark and cold and occupied by a Tibetan doctor who wore none of the paraphernalia that I'd been expecting. So he was expecting the Tibetan doctor also, yes, so wearing a long coat or doctors wearing the white coat with the stethoscope and everything. But no, this person was very different. No white coat. He looked like any other Tibetan with a thick pullover and a woolly hat. When I explained my sleepless symptoms and my sudden aversion to lying down, he shot me a few questions while feeling the veins in my wrist. So once again, you know, when we have a problem, we think, oh my God, I have the biggest problem on earth, right? This is such a medical, serious medical issue that I have. But when we go to the doctor is there treating it very casually, very lightly, because for him, it is something very regular, right? So routine kind of a thing for him. So the doctor here, and the doctor was not looking like a doctor, another problem. He was not wearing a white coat, and he was looking like any other ordinary Tibetan who was there. Okay, so he's checking him. It's a cold, he said finally through Seton, a cold and the effects of altitude. I'll give you something for it. I asked him if he thought I'd recover enough to be able to do the Kora. Oh yes, he said, you'll be fine, right? So we'll stop here for the day. And yes, let us just revise what we have discussed till now.